order to use that. So that is one issue. Like you don't see anybody, you are talking to almost yourself, and the screen time, that is another issue. It causes some kind of issue, some kind of problem. But otherwise, I think we are getting used to it. I think this is what is going to happen for the next whole semester. Okay. So somehow we have to get used to it.
Well, what is the feedback from the students about online teaching?
More or less the same. We had a survey actually for teachers as well as students. So we immediately in first week we had a survey. Then in the in after 2 weeks I suppose we had another survey. So the students were not very comfortable, but at the same time they one very important thing which was the outcome of the survey is that students are engaged. So that that distraction happens, you know. Say for example, today's 2 hour session, we probably will not think about COVID during those 2 hours. So if you just distract yourself, so it will help you, you know, in certain way. So that is what students' feedback was there, that they were engaged, and they were also trying to grasp the ideas. But this internet issue was one of the main issue which students raised. Unstable internet connection. Not access to proper connection. So that was one of the issues.
And also availability of data.
Data in the sense?
Actually, some students may have 1.5 GB or 2 GB.
Yes. Internet. That is related internet. Yes, absolutely true.
If you keep 3 or 4 classes in a particular day, how can they attend all the classes?
Yes, that is a big issue. So IIT Patna, what it did is that it gave students 500 rupees per month and asked them to utilize that money for, you know, better internet pack. So probably our students did not face that issue much because they most probably they had that, because I don't remember them mentioning that data issue because we are providing data.
Okay, in one way you are safe.
Yeah.
And what about the conduct of online examination? You conducted only MCQ type or?
No, so we had, you can say, 2 ways of evaluation. First evaluation for the final year graduates was done. That was at the end of May, I think. End of May, yes. June first week, end of May to June first week. So during that period, what happened? They were given a time frame, let us say 2 hours, and during that 2 hours, they had to answer the questions. So they were sitting in front of their mobile device or computer or anything, and then it was just like, you know, in-home examination. So for that, some teachers opted for descriptive answers, some opted for objective answers. So individual to individual, it varied. But most of the people opted for a descriptive answer, because in objective answer, you know, even if a couple of students can communicate via WhatsApp, then the answer is easily known to all. So most of the people opted for the descriptive type question, so that they can know that whether the student understand the concept or not. And after that, some of the faculty members also use the idea of viva voce. So they took a viva voce, whether they really had the concept or they have just, you know, got the answer from somewhere or with the help of somebody. So that is what one way of evaluation was done during the first phase. And that was a 2 hour examination, monitored examination, and students submitted their answer sheets at the end of the 2 hours. Now, for the rest of the students, that was for final year only. Now for the rest of the students, it was found that methodology was, though it was good, but it is very difficult to manage with almost all students. So Senate adopted another methodology that for first year students, the grading will be done on the basis of their already evaluations, which are up to mid semester. For second year and third year students, the grading will be done on the basis of first year BTech I was talking about. And other first year like MTech and MSc, they in addition to that second year BTechs and all the students, they will be provided with assignment. And we will increase the weightage of our mid-semester, because that was already done in person here. So in So the weightage is increased for the mid semester, weightage is reduced for the end semester, and the end semester examination will be assignment based examination. So we will provide the students the assignments and they can submit the assignments in 2 days.
Okay.
Yeah, so that is the way we have done it now. The examination are still going up to 17th tomorrow. Those kind of examination will take place. See, it's very difficult to evaluate actually. It's very, very difficult to evaluate. The idea of examination, if you see in general, is that without any help, the candidate is doing whatever examination we provide the candidate. But in this kind of examination, you can never be sure. You only have to trust. So trust is the only factor which we have at the moment, that okay, we trust that the students will not do any kind of mischief. The major issue is with the number of students. For example, first year, BTech first year, unmanageable.
The strength is more.
Yeah, we have around 400 students at this moment. And that's difficult to keep track of. So unless until we develop something which is proper online, or we buy some software which is made for this online examination, I think it's difficult.
Any idea about JEE? Are they going to have it or are they going to scrap it? Any idea?
So far they have not said that they will scrap it. And I don't think that there is any plan to scrap it unless until the problem persists till December. Otherwise, JEE Advanced will happen. Only thing, admissions will get delayed. Like normally we admit in August. So this time, I think maybe the admission will happen in January or something like that. There is a chance. We really... So there is supposed to be one meeting either today or maybe tomorrow. The JAB meeting, that is a body for this JEE examination. In Delhi, they will meet and hopefully the outcome will be announced by today or tomorrow.
Because if you delay, admission will get delayed, conduct of classes will get delayed, the first year entire process will be delayed.
Yes, but there is no option. I mean, you can't do anything. There is no solution to that. Even the results...
I think only JEE and NEET, only these two examinations are not decided about the conduct or non-conduct of the exams.
Yes. You are talking about JEE mains.
JEE main. Yeah. Main, yeah. Yes. Then advanced and also NEET examination.
Yes. NEET and JEE mains are the two important examinations, which are, I think, they need to be decided. So probably they are also on hold. I think they are also on hold. They are not canceled yet. And JEE Advanced is dependent on JEE Mains.
Yeah.
So let us see nowadays, whether...
The state government is announcing the plus two results nowadays, slowly, one by one. All the states are announcing. So the pressure is on the students now, whether the government of India is going to conduct the next chance of main exam and advanced examination or not. That is going to be a next pressure on the students.
I think very soon there should be some announcement from government side. I think there are multiple factors. For example, JEE Advanced, we usually call for a top 20 percentile or 75%. Maybe this time they will remove that condition possibly. So those kind of things probably they will do for helping the students. That is what my intuition is. That is what my understanding also being inside the system. So I think some kind of exemptions might be provided to the students so that there will not be any kind of panic and there will not be any kind of pressure. Feeling the pressure or feeling the need to be depressed or anything. So students will not feel that. I think some support will be from these organizations, JEE Advanced, government, or these. I hope so.
Okay.
So let us hope for the best.
Okay, thank you for sharing your ideas about online education and the conduct of JEE exams, sir. Thank you. Babuji, now what about the strength? It has reached 90. Babuji?
87, sir.
Okay, and also it is 3-5. I think you can start, right?
Yes, sir, you can start, sir.
So are you going to enforce waiting room today?
Yeah, sir.
Please do it.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Good evening to all present here. I welcome all of you for this online e-meeting, online faculty development program, which is being organized in our department. I welcome the speaker of the day, Professor Prashant Srivatsava, who is ready to give a lecture on mathematical biology. And also, I thank him for accepting our invitation in short notice. I also thank him for spending his most valuable time with us. And for the benefit, for the recap of, just I would like to recap the event to the speaker. Sir, for your information, since all the universities and colleges are closed, the universities gave us on duty. With the request of our management, we are organizing two programs, one for the benefit of our research scholars and one for the benefit of our own faculty members. We are actually organizing, and today is the last day for the event called the Faculty Development Program, which was started on 6th July, and it is being organized up to today, and today is the last day and last session, and you happen to be the last speaker of the day in this program. And this is conducted for the benefit of our faculty members belonging to Ramapuram campus, Vadapandi campus, and Modinagar campus, and all faculty members belonging to SRM group. The main idea is to give an exposure to all the faculty members, to give an exposure to all the faculty members about online teaching, online classes, and to make them aware of all the research areas which is available in the latest development of mathematical arena, and to give exposure about various research activities that is happening around the world. And also, whenever they listen from the speaker's point of view, it will be very useful for them. And we are organizing a second program called Research Development Program. It is exclusively for the benefit of research scholars, which we are starting from tomorrow, and it will go up to 28th of July. For just recapping the program, today's happened to be the last date. I just want to say a few things about our program. We started the program on 6th July, and Professor Venkatesan was the first speaker of the day on 6th July. He gave the talk on applications of statistics in machine learning. And the second day was 7th July. It was the talk was given by Professor Bhaskar Babuji, Associate Professor MIT Crompet, and he gave the talk on number theory and applications of number theory in cryptography. And the day three was started with a talk by Professor HB Rani, Associate Professor NIT Warangal. She gave a talk on finite volume methods and real-time applications. The day four started with, day four we had two talks, one by Dr. Vesi Subhashini. She gave a review about her perception about partial differential equations and its application. On the same day, we had another talk by Tamil Chalvan. He gave a talk on generalized zero divisors, graphs from commutative rings. And day five was, during day five, we had two talks, and both of the speakers are from Baba Atomic Research Institute, Mumbai. For the first person was Dabani Kral. He gave a talk on how to teach online engineering mathematics. And during the same day, the second person on that day was Dr. Debadatta Datta. He gave the talk on how to teach engineering maths applied to physics design. And the sixth day started with Professor. There was two persons on sixth day. Both of them are from IIT Chennai. The first person of the day was Professor Satyajit Roy. He gave the talk on linearization technique for nonlinear boundary problems, ODE and PDE. And on the same day, the second lecture was by Professor, given by Professor Sanyasi Raju. He talked on meshless numerical schemes. Then on Sunday, 12th of July, it happens to be the seventh day. And Professor Lakshmanan, who is also present here, I welcome you, sir, for our meeting. Professor Lakshmanan gave the talk on nonlinear dynamics and evolution and evolving science. And then during the eighth day, we had the talk by Professor Krishna Padadas, who gave the talk on mathematical modeling on echo epidemiology with the basic reproduction number and chaos. Then on Monday, that is 14th July, that is the ninth day for our program, we had the talk from Deepak Kumar Jana. He gave the talk on soft computing. He explained about fuzzy type 1 sets and fuzzy type 2 sets, how they are applied. And he gave a nice presentation on the day. And yesterday we had the talk by Professor Tamil Chelvan, who gave the talk on collinear coordinates and their applications. And today happens to be the 11th day and also last day. Today we are having two lectures. In the morning session, we had a talk from Professor Koikilavani, Anna University, who gave the talk on Fourier transform and its application. And of course, the last session of the day and the last day, last session will be by Professor Prashant Srivatsava, who is going to give the talk on geometric representation of solution of differential equations. So I'm very happy to say these few words to our speaker. I'm very happy that he has spent most, free to spend his time with us, and he's going to give a lecture on application, geometrical applications of differential equation. In this regard, I request Dr. Balamuridharan to introduce the speaker to the audience. Balamuridharan, please.
Okay, sir. A warm welcome and press good afternoon to everyone gathered here. Dr. Prashant Kumar Srivastava did his BSc and MSc from CSJM University, Kanpur in 1999 and 2001. He earned his PhD from IIT Kanpur in 2010 on mathematical modeling of HAV dynamics in vivo. He continued there as NPHM postdoctoral fellow before joining BITS Bilani campus for a short period, and then finally moving to IIT Patna in December 2011, where he is working as associate professor at present in the Department of Mathematics. His research interest includes mathematical modeling, nonlinear dynamics, time delay models, optimal control, modeling infectious disease dynamics, mathematical models in management, behavioral dynamics, mathematical models in immunology and related areas. He has more than 15 years of teaching and research experience. He has been awarded the Best Teacher Award by IIT Patna and SBI 2013 and by IIT Kanpur 2007. He was selected for Best Paper Award in Biomathematics at 74th IMS 2008. He is an elected member of National Academy of Sciences. He is an elected member of National Academy of Sciences in India, Allahabad. Apart from this, he was also selected for D.S. Kothari Postdoctoral Fellowship, removed various reputed travel grants, and a Bharat Vikas Award 2018. He is handling a project under metric scheme of DST SERB. He has been a resource person to various national and international workshops, including NPTE program of DST and IIT Paul of MHRD. He has delivered more than 35 invited talks, keynote addresses in various national and international fora. He has visited Italy, China, Russia, and South Africa for his research dissemination. He has published more than 20 research articles. I welcome you, sir. Thank you so much for accepting my invitation for this EEFDP. I request HOD sir to start the session.
Thank you for introducing the speaker of the day, Dr. Balamuridharan. And I am very happy that Professor Prashant Sivasava has readily agreed for our to our invitation. We are very happy that he is spending most of his valuable time with us. And on behalf of Department of Mathematics, I request him to deliver his lecture. Sir, please, please, sir.
சார் அவர் கோ கோஸ்டா மாத்திருங்க சார் அன்மியூட் இது பண்ண முடியலையா
பண்ண முடியலையாமா
பாபுஜி சார் பாபுஜி சார்
சொல்லுமாலா
சார் சார் வந்து அன்மியூட் பண்ண முடியலையா சார் கோ கோஸ்டா
மாத்திருங்க அவர் பண்ணட்டே அவர் நீ
அப்படிங்களா இல்ல கேட்க மாட்டேங்குதுன்னு சொல்றாங்க சார்
கால் வர வர அவர்
சார் ஆர் யூ ஏபிள் டு லிசன் அஸ் யூ அன்மியூட் யுவர் மைக்
sir now
you
can do sir
yeah now it is allowed actually in between I got again
yeah disconnected I made it actually initially
yes
thank you sir no problem sir
so once again if that happens the disconnection happens then kindly
again I'll yeah. take care sir
yes thank you so much thank you professor Arunachalam and professor Bala Muralidharan and others those who are behind the scene for inviting me and providing me opportunity to share my thoughts with you and it is indeed during this time of COVID it is indeed a good exercise to keep ourselves distracted from at least keep ourselves engaged with the academics and keep ourselves distracted for some time and this is helping most of us I suppose and that is what I believe and I would like to share the slides and I hope the slides are visible to you now if somebody can confirm it
yes sir it is visible
all right thank you so basically I was talking so much about the infectious disease dynamics and other stuff which is related to research and since this was FTP program so initially I thought what I should talk about which will be of interest to almost all people because research topics sometimes may be of interest to a small bunch of people but may not be of interest to the rest of the people and this probably will be for the wide spectrum of faculty members so I thought to choose a topic which is related to differential equation and what I thought is that possibly this will connect almost all the faculty members of the institute and hopefully this will give some information something new to them so that is the reason why I chose this particular topic and this is very interesting this is very very interesting topic this unfolds lot of aspects about the differential equations so we all know about the differential equations basically they represent in some certain kind of changes so if you need to represent certain kind of changes you need differential equations in general life we talk about a first order differential equation we can say let us so in this talk I will assume that my variable is x and the independent variable is t and this is a real variable so let xt be in R the unknown function of t and let f be some function which is from R cross R to R this function I have assumed to be the continuous function with continuous partial derivative with respect to x so on some closed interval so this is the initial assumption we can actually reduce some of the assumptions here but that is okay this is what the initial assumption so that there are certain theory of differential equations classical theory of differential equation which will not create any kind of problem so let us assume in general a very simple first order differential equation x prime is equals to f of tx where f is a again continuous function in the both the variables and therefore this is our first order differential equation now we say that the function if this function f is independent of t, all this in this equation as autonomous equation depending on the function f whether it is a linear function of x or a non-linear function of x, call the differential equation to be linear or non-linear differential equation. So these are some very basic ideas about this. If you
Nirmala, kindly mute your mic. Nirmala, kindly mute your mic. Nirmala K, kindly mute your mic.
If you consider the function fx as ax, very simple linear equation. This is very simple equation, and with the initial condition, this is initial condition. X naught is equal to x naught. Then it can be easily verified that the solution can be represented by x exponential function in this fashion. So all these things are very trivial. These things we have done at plus two level, and there is a theorem which is called existence and uniqueness theorem, which we call Picard-Lindelof theorem. The theorem says that this differential equation, along with the initial condition x t naught is equals to x naught, has unique solution in the neighborhood of t naught x naught, provided the conditions are satisfied, which I have mentioned here, that the continuous function f should be continuous and the partial derivative of f should be continuous in the closed interval I. So in any closed interval I, which is containing our point t naught x naught, if that condition is satisfied, then the existence and uniqueness theorem, which we called as Picard-Lindelof theorem, that guarantees that there exists a unique solution. However, this theorem does not tell how to find out solution. It just tells that there exists a solution or there exists a unique solution. So if function is continuous, then we call that there exists a solution. If this function is continuous and if the function has continuous partial derivatives, or if you want to reduce this condition, then you can call it Lipschitz continuity. So if you impose the Lipschitz continuity, then also it will tell that the solution is unique. So that is called uniqueness condition. So what is the important message is that there is no general method to find a solution for this first order initial value problem, x prime is equals to ftx and xt naught is equals to x naught. Though we can establish that there exists a solution, we can, in general, we cannot find that what that solution might be. And therefore, the qualitative methods, which I'm going to talk about in this talk, that is the geometric method, these methods sometimes help us to understand the pattern of the solution. Instead of getting the exact solution of the method, the pattern of the solution can be found. So we may not know what is the closed form, what is the functional form of the solution, but we can know how the solution behaves. So we will talk about in some time, we will talk about that, what those things are. So this whole talk is about this aspect, this qualitative aspect of the solution of the differential equation. Let us talk about the system. So we know that any nth order differential equation, we can convert it into a system of differential equations having n variables, x1, x2 to xn, and these n functions, f1 to fn. So if these functions f satisfies the existence uniqueness condition, which I mentioned, the continuity and the partial derivatives, etc. So we say that there exists a unique solution. So it means that in general, we can consider the differential equation dx over dt is equals to f of tx, where x may be a scalar value or x may be a vector value. So the form of the equation will in general be of the type dx over dt is equals to f of tx. Again, as mentioned earlier, if f is independent of t, we call it autonomous, and linear and non-linear according to the function f, whether f is linear in x, please note that, or f is non-linear in x. So what is the autonomous system? As I mentioned, that if it is independent of t, then we can write this as autonomous. Why are we calling it as a system? Because these are n variables. X is actually a vector, therefore these are n equations. So in sense, these equations are actually n equations, n simultaneous equations which are written there, and therefore we call them as a system of n ordinary differential equations. And these are autonomous equations, these are non-autonomous. So this is just a very basic building block for us, which probably we will be looking at. I have chosen one very simple example. For example, x prime is equals to sine x. So this is a scalar equation. And x1 prime is equals to x1 plus x1 x2. X2 prime is equals to x1 square plus x2, which is f1 and f2. So this is a system of equation. Equivalently, we can see that this is a system of equation where the bold x is actually the variable x1, x2, and the bold f is f1, f2. So this is how we have represented. So now we can clearly identify how we can see a differential equation and how we can see a system of differential equation. So what I would like to underline here is that the existence and uniqueness theorem, it just tells about that there exists a solution which is a unique solution. As I mentioned, that this theorem does not tell how to find a solution. However, if one look at it closely and one see how the proof goes on, then one can actually utilize the idea of the proof itself in order to construct the solution. What do I mean by the construct of the solution? I will try to help with the help of an example. So let us consider this example. This is a simple linear equation. X prime is equals to t plus x. So this is a linear equation, and this is initial condition x zero is equals to one. If you recall the proof of your Picard's theorem, what it does is at the very first step is that it constructs the Picard iterates. And how do we get the Picard iterates? We integrate both the sides. So we integrate both the sides from the limit zero to t. If I integrate the left hand side, I will get x t minus x naught, and right hand side I will get integration from zero to t, this function t plus x dt. Now what I will do is that I will make the iterations out of it, because both x is available on both left hand side and right hand side. So I will simplify the x on the left hand side, shift x zero to the right hand side, and this integral term, in this, I will replace this x by indexing. So what I do is that x on the right left hand side will be evaluated value corresponding to the previous value of x on the right hand side. And this way I will generate my iterates. And in the proof, it is shown that essentially this ultimately turns out to be a Cauchy sequence, which one can actually see, but this is not the point which I'm trying to convey here. So Picard iterates in general can be found in the form of xn is equals to x0 plus integration from 0 to t f is missing here, I'm sorry for the typo, f of t xn minus 1 dt. So your right hand side function ftx actually becomes the integral, and this x0 appears here, and this way you can actually evaluate your all xn. So these are the iterates which you can evaluate. So as n goes larger and larger, rather as n tends to infinity, your xn goes to the actual solution of the differential equation. That means as n goes to infinity, xn goes to x. So we can construct these iterates and we can find out that what the solution will look like. So let us take the example in our case. In place of this ft xn minus 1, we will put this expression that will become t plus xn minus 1. And start putting the value for n is equals to 1, 2, 3, 4. So x0, as I know, x0 is x at the beginning. So x0 is basically 1. So x0 is 1. I will start with x1 for n is equals to 1. Here I will put n is equals to 1. So it will become 0. So what I will get is x1 is equals to x0, which is 1, plus integral of t plus x0, which is 1. So 1 plus t integral will give me t plus t square by 2. So I will get my first iterate as x1. Similarly, I will get my second iterate x2 as x0 plus t plus x1 integral. So that t plus x1 integral will give me this much. And similarly, I will get my x4 iterates. So you can see easily that how these iterates are written here. So a pattern starts arising. 1 plus t square. And the last term is t cube by 6. That is 3 factorial. Okay. Here x4. So you can easily see that this will be like 1 plus t square plus t cube by 3 plus t raised to power 4. I think there is a typo here. This should be x3, I believe. This should be x3. This should be x3, I believe. Yeah, this should be x3 instead of x4. This should be x3. So t3 by 3. And then t4 by 4 factorial, if you notice it carefully. So the pattern start arising, and if I keep on going, I can write my the nth term. And here this xn goes like 1 plus t plus t square plus t cube by 3 plus t raised to power 4 by you can say 12, and then so on so forth. So the pattern is like this is the these are the terms of the exponential function, but they are essentially multiplied by 2 from here onwards. So you can write actually the solution, since I know the actual solution and most of us know the actual solution. So you can write the solution as t and n goes to infinity. This series basically goes to closer and closer to minus 1 minus t plus 2 e raised to power t. The point here which I'm trying to make is that since we know the exponentiation, and therefore we can actually write, instead of the series, we can write this exponential function. But in general, this may not be true. I mean, in general, we may not be able to get a closed form function. So we may have to write the solution in form of a series. But ultimately, if we know certain kind of functions, we can get a solution. So for a simple looking equation, we can construct a solution out of the differential equation. So the process of the constructing solution has a drawback, as I mentioned here. The drawback is that if the integrand, which is the integral f of tx, if this integrand is very difficult to integrate, or if it is very cumbersome, then you know you after x1, x2, x3, it will become very difficult to evaluate, and therefore the construction of the solution will be very difficult. So this is a huge drawback. This may lead to a tedious calculation, and even the simple cases of differential equation, the solution might be difficult. So one can use it, but as I showed you that there is a difficulty, one may not be always able to succeed for the case of differential equation. However, it is definitely important tool for constructing the solution of an initial value problem. You all know that this equation can also be solved by using simply the integrating factor and then finding out the actual solution and putting the condition for the initial condition. I'm not getting into the actual methods of solutions, but because that is not my aim, but still for the sake of being sure, you can actually make yourself sure that this is actual solution. So you can figure out that this is the solution, and if we figure out from the sequence of Picardic rates, then as n goes to infinity, our solution actually lands to this solution. Let us take another example, which is a non-linear in nature, because x square is appearing here. This is a very simple and innocent looking equation, but I think we always give this example. Most of us, those who teach differential equation, they might remember this equation, that we always give this equation as an example, that it is not possible to find out the closed form solution of this differential equation. So what do we resort to? We resort to something called our series solutions, just like the way I have done for the Picard citrate, or other methods of numerical solution, etc., can be implemented in order to find out the solution of this differential equation. However, we would like to talk about another aspect of finding out the solution, which we call it geometric approach or the qualitative solution. What is that? So for that, let us go back. So let us go back again to our differential equation. What the differential equation is, x prime is equals to f of tx. What does it represent? The left hand side is the derivative of dx or dt, and the right hand side is the function, which is some function, which is known function. For example, in previous example, it was t plus x. In another example, it is t square plus x square. So this is known. So what this x prime actually represents? In two-dimensional Tx plane, this x prime represents the derivative of x with respect to t, which means it is actually representing the tangential direction, to the function xt at the point t comma x. This means this is the slope of the tangent of unknown function xt at the point t comma x, and which is equal to the right-hand side, which means that at every point, I know what is the slope of the unknown function. That's very interesting if I look at the equation from this point of view. So this differential equation essentially is nothing but the slope of the tangent of the unknown function xt, xt is basically the solution of the differential equation. So that unknown function xt, this is the slope at each and every point. So what if I plot ftx in my tx plane? And then I get the slope at each and every point, and then I keep on moving and along those slopes, then I can get the solution. I will explain it here in with the help of this figure. Let us locate ourselves at the point p naught, which is at t naught comma x naught. So at the point t naught comma x naught, I can evaluate the value of f of t naught x naught, and f of t naught x naught, that value will be nothing but the slope of the tangent, and therefore it tells me that how the solution moves. So solution tangentially moves. So I will move in the direction. In order to find out the solution, I'll move tangentially to that function, and I will move, let us say, one step, and I will reach to the point P1. Now at this point P1, again, this is, let us say, point T1 comma X1. I will again evaluate the value of the tangent, and then I will move to one more step in the direction of that tangent, and I will move to the point P2. Then from the point P2, I will again find out what is the direction of the tangent here. And then again, I will move to the next point P3, and then so on and so forth. So you can see that this way I'm traversing a path. Which path? The path which is showing that this is tangential. At each point, these slopes are actually tangential to my curve x is equals to xt. So if I keep, of course, this is having certain error. If I keep these points P0, P1, and P2 close enough, then I can actually construct a solution here. Now, if you look at that, this problem looks very cumbersome, that evaluate all the points FTX at all the points T's and X in the whole of TX, that is whole of R2 plane. So evaluating all the slopes in the entire plane might be a very cumbersome job. But then there comes something for our rescue, which tells us that it's not necessary that you evaluate all of them. Rather, there is a way that you can evaluate certain functions where you know the slopes are constant. And where the slopes will be constant, wherever dx over dt is equals to constant, which means ftx is equals to constant. So I get in two-dimensional plane, I get ftx, this is a function of two variable. And this function, we call it isocline, because on each point of this particular function ftx is equals to c, the slope is constant c. And then we can measure the angle which is made by the horizontal theta. We can find out tan theta is equals to c. And that is, with the help of that, we can draw the slope or the gradient at each point of these isoclines. And then we can construct the solution. I will show you with the help of one example. I think some of you must have seen this. So this is how we do. So let us consider the example which we have already done. This is x prime is equals to t plus x, 0 is equals to 1. So for the isocline, we have to plot t plus x is equals to c. I think you can easily see that t plus x is equals to c for different values of c. This is nothing but a set of parallel lines which are having an angle of a straight line with a slope of, I'm sorry, it's not 45 degrees, it's minus 45 degree. A slope of minus 45 degree, which is 135 degree. So these are the straight lines. So let us start putting the values when c is equals to 0. So when c is equals to 0, you will get the line t plus x is equals to 0. So this is the line t plus x is equals to 0. On this line, you can see the slope is c is equals to 0. That means the tangent is making a 0 degree angle on each point. So that's why I have made a small elements here which are depicting the direction of the tangent, and those directions are actually parallel to x-axis. You can easily see these are parallel to x-axis. So on each point of this line, the direction of the tangent is parallel to the x-axis. The next line which I have plotted is t plus x is equals to 1. As you can easily see, t plus x is equals to 1 implies that c is equals to 1. So dx over dt, that means here the slope is 1. Slope is 1 where the theta is equals to pi by 4 or 45 degree. So on this line, the slope lines will make 45 degree. Therefore, instead of here, the slope lines were making a 0 degree. Here, the slope lines are making 45 degree. So you make here small elements which are making a 45 degree angle with the horizontal. 45 degree angle with the horizontal. And similarly, I have plotted x plus t is equals to 2. So x plus t is equals to 2. So tan inverse 2 becomes around 63 degrees. So here you have to make the angles with 63 degrees, and the next one is for express T is equals to 3. So that becomes around 71.5 degrees. So we put the small element which are making an angle of 71.5 degrees with the horizontal, and similarly we can plot express T is equal to -1, which will make as 135 degrees. Then -2, which will make as -65 degrees, and then so on and so forth. So if you want to make so many curves, these isoclines, these straight lines are isoclines, and these small elements basically represent the direction of the tangent of the solution curve. Now, if I want to fill it, I can fill it with as many curves as I want to, depending on when I get tired. In fact, this can also be done using some software like Mathematica or MATLAB. Mathematica or MATLAB. You can actually draw these directions. And you can actually figure out that what will be the solution. In order to find out the solution, as I told you, I have to start with some points. So my initial point, for example, here is x0 is equals to 1. So if I start at x0 is equals to 1, this is actually x0 is equals to 1. You can easily see this intersects with the line t plus x is equals to 1. So this is the point x0 is equal to 1. On this point, I am told to move in the direction of 45 degrees. So how will I move? I'll move making a direction of 45 degrees from here. And then I will reach to this line. And there I will make an angle of 63 degrees. So I will start moving that angle of 63 degrees till I reach to another line express 2 is equal to 3, where I am told that I have to move with the angle of 71 degrees. So my solution curve, forward solution curve, you can see it moves like this way, right? And then similarly, I can make my backward solution curve. So starting from 45 degrees, when I reach to this curve, my angle should be 0 degrees. Then my angle should be 135 degrees, and then so on and so forth. My angle should be, so according to the points, I will keep on moving, and then I will keep on tracing the solution. I will keep on tracing the curve, which is with the help of these tangential directions. So essentially, geometrically, the work which we have done earlier, like -1 - t plus twice of e raised to power t, that curve is actually plotted here. This is the curve which is actually plotted here. So we can see that how the solution behaves. In fact, if you want to take the information, you can see that this curve is growing. Suppose if you don't want to know what is the exact value and you just want to know what is the pattern, you can see that this is the shape of the curve. So this is a good enough information. Now I will take the example of another example, which I have already showed you. I will not be discussing many details here, but the few of them I will discuss here. For example, we can see that FTX, as I make it as a constant C, because I want to figure out what are the isoclines, you can see that this is T squared plus X squared is equal to C. Now, instead of writing C, I have written it as C squared. I could have written it as C also, but I have written it as C squared, just to make you comfortable with the form of expression that this is nothing but concentric circle. Also, this t square and x square, these are the sum of squares. Therefore, c can never be negative. So the value of the slope can never be negative. So the half of the part of your tangent function is actually left out. Only what value you can select here is from 0 to infinity. So then that is also rational if instead of c, you write c square. Because suppose you write this t square plus x square is equals to c, and that c is being a non-negative value, you can write it as a square. So there is no problem with that, I hope. Now we keep on changing the value of C from 0 to infinity. And I have mentioned it as a large number because we cannot reach infinity in reality. So we get the concentric circles. So when T is equals to 0, you will get a point circle. And when, let us say, T is equals to, say, 1 by root 3, then you will get a circle of radius 1 by 3, if you take the t is equals to 1 by root 3, so you will get a circle of radius 1 by root 3 as t square plus x square is equals to 1 by 3. And then let us say when you put x is equals to 1, this is actually put here 1 here, so if you put x is equal c is equals to 1, then t square plus x square is equals to 1, so you will get a circle of radius 1. So all these values in the similar fashion, you will evaluate and you will start putting these small elements. Say, for example, for 1, tan inverse 1 is pi by 4. So therefore, or 45 degrees. Therefore, on this circle, each point will have inclination of 45 degree. So on each point you will make an inclination of 45 degree. And similarly for the case of 1 by root 3, so tan inverse 1 by root 3 is nothing but pi by 3. So in that case you will make an angle of pi by 6. So you will make an angle of pi by 6, and then so on and so forth. So you will see that the angles, when you start circle from inside out, the angle will, because tangent is an increasing function, so your angles will start increasing from 0 to pi by 6 to pi by 4 to so on and so forth. So you can evaluate them, as many numbers as you can evaluate, then you can figure out that these concentric circles will have the slope which is increasing. So on each of the circles, slope is increasing. That is what we can easily see from here. And in order to draw the solution, we can choose any of the initial condition. For example, you can see that the initial condition is chosen here. Let us say this curve is chosen here. So this is the x0 value. So it again tells you that how to move forward. So move forward in the direction of these small elements, and how to move backward. Move backward in the direction of, again, these small elements. And in the similar fashion, you can draw the curve, these solution curves also. So these are the solution curve. And there can be only one solution curve which will be passing through this origin. The reason being is very simple, because if there are two curves which are passing through the origin, then you can see that the two different curves will be there at the origin. And at the origin, there will be two directions. That means the slope of, there will be two slopes of the tangent. And the slopes of the tangent, if there are two slopes of the tangent, then there will be two slopes. However, you have already seen that at the origin, there is only one slope, which is zero. And this can also be actually concluded from here with the function f of tx. If there is a continuity of the function f of tx, then you will be getting a unique slope at every point. And therefore, there can be only one curve which is passing through the origin. So this this idea, one can actually exercise this idea. This is the reference from where this particular figure is taken, SL Ross differential equation. One can go through and one can brush up more, and then one can see this idea. I hope some of you must have, those who have taught differential equation must have gone through all these things. But this is the very basic idea, that how we can apply the idea of the gradient, and we can construct the solutions of any differential equation, which in general we are not able to find out. For example, the solution of this differential equation, it becomes very cumbersome unless until we apply the numerical technique. And the numerical technique, application of the numerical technique, just only gives you one solution. But here, with the help of this idea, we can get the multiple solutions and their patterns. We can easily see that how those patterns actually arise, how the solution patterns arise. If I now move further, and if I, instead of the scalar equation, I want to look at that how my system works for this case. That, as I mentioned, these equations, when we solve, we can solve. We can get the differential equation which are higher in order. So how can we apply the understanding which we have just developed? Can it be translated similarly into the higher dimension? The answer is yes, to some extent. We may not be able to do it for all the cases, because visualization of higher dimension higher than 3 is difficult, but still we can do it easily for 2-dimensional cases. And my focus today will be only 2-dimensional cases. And in fact, this whole idea can further be generalized. And this can further be generalized for n dimension, but that is not the point which I am going to talk about today. I will be only talking about two-dimensional equation. So the two-dimensional equation in general can be written as dx over dt is equals to ax plus by. This is a linear system. So I'm going through first with the linear one, and dy over dt is equals to cx plus dy. So the whole system is a linear system. So this can also be written in form of a matrix equation, a, b, c, d of x, y. So in general, as I already mentioned, this equation can be thought that d capital X over dt is equals to some matrix M times capital X. So this is similar to our dx over dt is equal to ax equation. And therefore, this assumption that our solution might be looking like constant time exponential lambda t serves as a good candidate to start with. So therefore, we assume that our solution xy might be looking like some capital A, capital B e raised to power lambda t, where A, B, and lambda are unknown to us. Once I substitute these, this means x is equals to A e raised to power lambda t and y is equals to B e raised to power lambda t. This means when I substitute this and simplify, then I get this equation, A minus lambda B C D minus lambda of AB e raised to power lambda t equals to zero. Exponential of lambda t, as we know that unless until lambda is minus infinity, this is not tending to zero, and therefore this matrix equation is zero, provided this matrix equation is zero. So because this is a scalar number, so I can ignore this number, because this number is anyway not going to zero. So once I get from after substitution, after this substitution in this system of differential equation, I lead to this matrix equation, and we know that this matrix equation have a non-trivial solution. What is non-trivial solution? The non-trivial solution means A and B non-zero. The non-trivial solution A and B, provided this determinant turns out to be zero. So A and B will be non-zero if this determinant is zero, which gives me the value or expression for the lambda. That means lambda square minus A plus D of lambda plus AD minus BC equals to zero. This is actually called characteristic equation. Why do I need my non-trivial solution? Because if I put A and B as zero, you can easily see x, y equals to zero, zero, and zero, zero is easily satisfied. So zero, zero is anyway is the solution of the system of differential equation. So I really, or for that matter, for any linear equation, you know, zero is always satisfied. Unless until we provide some kind of initial condition, so which we are not doing here, we are trying to make ourselves in more general case. So this system zero will always be a solution, and therefore we want a non-zero solution. All right. So in order to get the non-zero solution, we have to impose here that I need non-trivial A and B. So in order to get non-trivial A and B, the determinant of the coefficient matrix must be zero, which gives us characteristic equation. This is a second degree equation, and it has roots, and these roots can be classified as two distinct real roots, one complex, a pair of complex roots, or a real and repeated roots. So three of the situation may arise, and we will discuss this situation one by one. So let us take the example where dx over dt is of this form. In this case, this is the case of two distinct real roots, and we want to see how how geometrically the solution will look like. So again, we'll do the exercise, xy substitution as usual, and we get the characteristic equation as lambda square minus of a plus d lambda plus ad minus bc. So that gives you this equation, and which gives you two values of lambda, the characteristic values, minus 1 and minus 3. Both are real and negative. So you got real and distinct roots, real and negative, which are distinct roots. Corresponding to lambda is equals to minus 1, you can figure out what will be the eigenvector. In fact, if you look carefully, this matrix equation is nothing but your eigenvalue problem. Lambda is eigenvalue, AB is the eigenvector. So this is your eigenvalue problem, right? So we call actually them eigenvalue and eigenvector only. So the eigenvector corresponding to lambda is equals to minus 1 is given by 1, 0. That means you solve for putting the lambda is equals to minus 1. You solve for A and B, and you will get the value of A and B to be 1 and 0. Similarly, for lambda is equals to minus 3, you will get A and B as 1 and minus 1. Now, the question is how to write the solution of this differential equation. So as initially I mentioned, what is the solution? XY is equals to AB e raised to power lambda t. So this is eigenvector, this is eigenvalue. So corresponding to each eigenvalue, I will get one solution. At least in this case, minus 1, minus 3, I got two solutions. Now, my question is how to write my general solution. So the answer is very simple. Since this system, dx over dt is equals to, this is a linear system. And we know that in case of linear system, the superposition principle works. And therefore, writing down the solution of this differential equation, writing down the solution of this differential equation is not difficult for us. This is, the solution will be the linear combination of first solution and second solution. And therefore, the general solution xy is written as c1 times first solution plus c2 times second solution. So this is what the solution is represented. That means my x is c1 e raised to power minus t plus c2 e raised to power minus 3t, and y is equals to c2 minus c2 e raised to power minus 3t. I'll request for a 1 minute break. I'll get water and come. Kindly excuse me.
Babuji?
Yes, I'm back now.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah. So, so this solution, basically, now we have found the solution. Again, ultimately, we want to look at that how the solution looks like. So we would like to see geometrically the how solution will look like. We will be actually plotting this solution, and we will be looking. So here C1 and C2 are arbitrary constant, and we can assign any value to them. Therefore, what we will do is that we will try to explore all kind of values which C1 and C2 can have. So one option will be, we will first put C1 is equals to 0. Then we will get the solution only for C2. Then we will put C2 is equals to 0, and then we will get the solutions only for C1. That means one solution each, and then we will see how the combination of these solutions works. We'll try to plot them. So let us start with one by one. So let us put C1 is equals to 0. So if I put C1 is equals to 0, I get x is equals to C2 e raised to power minus 3t, and y is equals to minus C2 e raised to power minus 3t, which after eliminating t, I get as y is equals to minus x. So I plot this y is equals to minus x. If you see, this is the line, y is equals to minus x. But the point is that which among these lines is y is equals to minus x, whether this line or this line, because y is equals to minus x is actually this whole line. So to judge that, we start getting the values, because these are the values of x and y. So we start selecting the values of C2. So let us say we choose C2 is equals to plus 1, for example. So if I choose C2 is equal to plus 1, I will get x is equals to e raised to power minus 3t, and y is equals to minus e raised to power minus 3t. Is that understood? If I choose C2 is equals to plus 1 and C1 is equals to 0, then I will get x2 is equals to e raised to power minus 3t, and y is equals to minus e raised to power minus 3t. So notice that x is positive and y is negative. Whatever value of t you choose, x is positive and y is negative. X is positive and y is negative always happens in this fourth quadrant. That means the portion of y is equals to x solution, y is equal to minus x solution, is this solution, which lies in the fourth quadrant. All right. Now we'll start putting the values. So we'll start putting the value, let us say t is equals to 0. So t equals to 0 will give me x, c2 is already 1, t equals to 0 will give me x is equals to 1 and y is equals to minus 1. So x is equals to 1 and y is equals to minus 1. So this is the point here. So I have mentioned, now I did not mention it clearly. This is my x-axis, this is my y-axis, and since the solution will be in x, y and t plane, we are plotting the solution only in xy plane. We are not considering the t plane here. We are considering only the solution in xy plane. This is also sometimes called phase plane analysis, those who are aware of it. So at t is equals to 0, this is the point solution, okay? At t is equals to 0. Now what will happen as t becomes larger? It can be easily seen as t goes larger and larger, then x goes to 0 and y also goes to 0. So that means as t goes to infinity, my solution approaches to 0. As t goes to infinity, my solution approaches to 0. So this is the forward direction for increasing t. This is t is equal to 0. This is t is equal to infinity. So this is these values are for t lying between 0 and infinity. All the values of t lying between 0 and infinity, the solutions will be approaching here. Notice that even if I reach to infinity, I can never reach to the origin, because as t tends to infinity, then only x and y both goes to 0. That means I am not going to intersect at x is equals to 0. So this is one solution. This is one solution which is tending to infinity, tending to 0. This is tending to 0 as t tends to infinity. What happened to the backward side? The backward side can be easily seen by putting t is equals to minus infinity. As put t is equal to minus infinity, you can see x goes to infinity and y goes to minus infinity. So that becomes, that means this is the direction through which I will go to x is equal to plus infinity and y is equals to minus infinity. So it means that normally the time is counted from minus infinity to plus infinity. So if I consider time in that sense, then you can see that if I start from minus infinity, I will start having on this curve, and as soon as I reach to infinity via zero, I will reach to the point zero. So this is one of the solution. This is one of the solution of the differential equation, and this solution corresponds to the initial condition when c1 is equals to zero and c2 is equals to plus one. So if I put c1 is equal to zero and c2 is equal to plus one, I will get this solution. In the similar fashion, if I put c1 is equals to zero and c2 is equal to minus one. Notice. So c2 is equal to minus one, then I will get this part of the solution, okay, which is mentioned as two. Let us see how it happens. So as c2 is equals to minus one, x will be negative and y will be positive. X will be negative and y will be positive. That will happen in this quadrant, second quadrant, and therefore my solution will be actually this is the solution which is represented for c1 is equals to zero and c2 is equals to minus one. So this is how we have represented. In the similar fashion, we have done the trajectory, like first trajectory. In a similar fashion, we can figure out that as t goes to infinity, the solution goes to zero, and therefore the arrow direction should be inward. The arrow direction should be inward. So the solution is moving from both the sides, like it is moving from inward from one side and inward from the other side. So these are the two solutions out of so many solutions we have figured out. Now if we put c2 equal to zero in the similar fashion, therefore what we will get, x is equals to c1 e raised to power minus t and y is equals to zero. So in this case, you can see that the curve which you will get corresponding to this is y is equals to, after elimination of t, y equals to zero curve. Y is equal to zero is what? It is x-axis. Now again, we have to see that which part of x-axis are the actual part of the solution. That we can easily get by putting the special value to c1. So we can choose c1 as plus one. If we choose c1 as plus one, you can easily see that it is e raised to power t, which is always positive. That means we are having the right half of our x-axis, and as t goes to infinity, this x goes to zero, and therefore the direction of t will be inward. So the similar discussion as I have done here, in the similar fashion, I can see the direction of the solution curve will be inward. Similarly, if I put c1 is equal to minus one, if I put c1 is equals to minus one, where is that? Did I put it? C1 is equal to minus one. Yes. Similarly, if I put c1 is equals to minus one, then you can see that this will be the solution, because your x y will go to zero. So this will be the solution. So these are the solution trajectory 1, 2, 3, 4. Four solution trajectories we have plotted by choosing c1 is equals to zero, c2 is equal to plus minus one, and c2 is equal to zero, and c1 is equal to plus minus one. Now what about both of them non-zero? So now we will try to plot the trajectory when both c1 and c2 are non-zero. So if both c1 and c2 are non-zero, in that case you can see the solution is nothing but the linear combination of two vectors. I'm sorry. So this is the linear combination c1, let us say a1 a2 plus c2 b1 b2. So what is a1? A1 is e raised to power minus t, and what is b1? B1 is e raised to power minus 3t, and b2 is let us say minus e raised to power minus 3t. So this is the linear combination of two vectors, or essentially it is sum of two vectors, if you even consider this. So what is that the xy? What is the xy? It is the sum of the vectors c1 e raised to power minus t zero plus c2 e raised to power minus t comma minus c2 e raised to power minus t. So basically this is the sum of the two vectors. Let us rename these vectors as a1 a2 and b1 b2, small a1 a2, small b1 b2. And if I want to sum the two vectors, how do I do that? I will have to draw a point a1 a2. I will have, from there I will have to draw a point b1 b2, and I have to use the parallelogram, right? Parallelogram law, and then the diagonal of that parallelogram is actually the resultant vector, correct? So the sum of these two vectors is essentially the resultant vectors of these two. Now here I would like to discuss one idea. The idea is that if you add two vectors, say vector A and vector B, then the sum of the two vectors is given by vector A plus B. Now what you do is that you reduce the size of the vector A. Okay, you reduce the size of the vector A and let the size of vector B remain the same. Then what will happen? The resultant vector will shift parallel to the larger vector, which is vector B. Now you further reduce the size of A, the resultant vector will further reduce, further be parallel to the vector B. And if you keep on reducing the size of vector A, or in other words, if you say that if your vector A tends to zero, then the resultant vector will be parallel to the larger vector. Or in other words, I can say that whenever we are adding two vectors, the resultant vector is always parallel to the heavyweight vector. Let us use the word heavyweight. Okay, so we'll use the two words now, lightweight and heavyweight. So if we are adding two vectors among which one is lightweight and other is heavyweight, and if I want to know the direction of that vector, then I can roughly say the direction will be more or less the same as the heavyweight vector. So here also, if you see, these are two vectors. And if I want to know at any point what will be the direction of those two vectors, if I can understand which among these vectors is a heavyweight vector and which among these vectors is a lightweight vector, then I can say the direction will be actually the heavyweight vector. It is very easy to actually judge which among these vectors is heavyweight and which among these vectors is lightweight. How should I do that? Let us take T to be large. If I take T to be large, then you can easily see that E minus T will be larger than e raised to power minus 3t, because it is 3 times the exponentiation of e raised to power minus t. So basically e raised to power minus 3t will faster, for larger t, will faster decay than e raised to power minus t. So if t is large, then in that case, this particular vector 1, 0 will be your heavyweight vector. That means that the direction will be parallel to 1, 0. What is 1, 0? 1, 0 is your eigenvector. So if you want to know what will be the direction of this general vector, then that general vector direction will be parallel to 1, 0 for large t, and for small t, that means small t is what? T going to minus infinity. Because I told you, t is running from minus infinity to infinity. So t going to minus infinity, if t is going to minus infinity, then in that case, you can see that this fellow will be smaller and this fellow will be larger, because here exponentiation is 3 times. So therefore, in the case of smaller t, that means t tending to minus infinity, this vector will be heavyweight vector. That means the sum will be parallel to 1 and minus 1 eigenvector. So let us now put this in the proper perspective here. When c1 and c2 are not zero, then at that time, how this x and y will happen? So I have mentioned here that e raised to power minus t dominates when the t is large, and e raised to power minus t dominates when t is small. By small t, I mean t minus infinity, and by large t, I mean t is tending to infinity. So it means that let us take any solution trajectory. My solution trajectory as t is at minus infinity, those solution trajectories will be parallel to the vector, because e raised to power minus t dominates when t is small. So e raised to power minus 3t dominates. So when I am at minus infinity, my dominating direction will be the direction of 1 minus 1. And the direction of 1 minus 1 is the same as direction of this vector. So I will start parallel to this vector y is equals to x minus x line, and will keep on moving. And when I enter to 0, that means when I reach as t is equals to infinity, I'll become parallel to y is equals to 0 vector. 1 comma 0 vector means y is equals to 0 vector. So any solution now I can draw by this idea, I will start parallel to 1 minus 1, and ultimately I will go parallel to this x-axis. And this thing I will do for each of them. So you can see that all the curves are actually moving. So similarly here, starting parallel to 1 comma minus 1, and then ultimately moving parallel to this x-axis. Similarly, here starting parallel to 1 comma minus 1, y is equal to minus x curve, and then ultimately moving parallel to your 0, 0. So without actually, you see, doing anything, we have figured out that how the solution trajectories will formulate themselves. So all the solution trajectories, they are approaching to actually 0, 0. And that can be easily seen from the form of the solution, because as t goes to infinity, you can see that x and y will tend to 0, 0. And that is the reason that why everybody is tending to 0, 0. So this way, this is our final representation of the solution. This is the final representation of the solution for this kind of equation. When both the eigenvalues are negative, the solution trajectories will reach to 0, 0. And then this is how they will be reacting. So if one of them is positive, other is negative, then depending on that, which eigenvector will be dominating, the shape of this solution will actually change. One has to be really careful while drawing the solution trajectories. Now I will move to the next case. The next case is when there is a complex case. So I'm not getting into the details. The eigenvalues are found to be 4 plus minus 3i, and the corresponding eigenvector is found as 1 comma i. The real solutions one can get easily. I'm just directly getting into the real solution. The solutions are given by c1 first vector plus c2 second vector. Now again, what we will do is that we will start plotting, but here you can see that these are the sine and cosine vectors and the exponentials are there. So how to know that now in this case, what we should be expecting? So the idea is very simple. One can actually figure out that these are basically, these curves are actually spirals. These curves are actually spirals, and that can be seen from here. With a very basic idea, if you just keep the idea that you forget about this exponential curve, then exponential function, then you can see that x square plus y square is nothing but your c1 square plus c2 square, which will be actually a closed curve, which is like a circle. So therefore you will get a closed curve. That means that your solution trajectories will lie on the circle. If this e raised to power 4t were not there, but e raised to power 4t is there, that means that at every increasing point, you will be moving ahead. You will be moving because t is becoming larger and larger. If you start t from 0, then you can easily see that, let us say, start from t is equal to 0. So for t is equal to 0, you will be on a circle. At t is equal to 0, your first point will be on a circle. And t is equal to 0 plus anything, t1, then you will get exponential there. So that means you will be on a circle, but that will be the next point of the circle. You will be exterior of the circle. You will not be on that circle. You will move to the exterior of the circle. So this is how it will happen. This is how you can take reference of any of them. So they are moving on the circular direction, but every time the radius of the circle is increasing. The radius of the circle is increasing because of this exponential factor. So every time the radius of the circle is increasing, that also you can see x square plus y square is nothing but c1 square e raised to power 4t square plus c2 square e raised to power 4t square. So that can be seen. So because of this exponential factor, the radius keeps on increasing. And that is how it is spiraling out. So it moves in the circular direction, but it keeps on spiraling out. So it keeps on moving away from the origin. As t goes to minus infinity, you can see that these numbers will go to 0. So that means the beginning point is origin, and then after that it will blow out in the circular direction. Now one question is that why did I make it in a counter clockwise and not in a clockwise direction? That one can see easily from here, that how these vectors are. So you can put at t is equals to 0, so the vector will be 1 comma 0. So 1 comma 0 will be some point, let us say here, or here 1 comma 0 will be here 1 comma 0. And then you can choose another point, t is equal to, let us say, π/6. So it will give you π/2. So it will be 0 and 1. So it will be 0 and 1. So that point will be here. So the forward in time, one can see that point moves from this point to this point. And therefore, in the continuous forward in time, the point will be moving in the counterclockwise direction. Therefore, whatever picture I have drawn here, that picture actually makes sense. So these will be spiraling. In fact, if we have a purely imaginary case, for example, the real part is 0, then I think you can easily understand that there will be no exponentiation here. And in that case, you will get only closed curve. So that can also be seen. So you will, instead of getting a spiral, you will get center. We call it center. You will get closed curves. Then repeated root, I think I would like to skip this one, but in the similar fashion, you can get the repeated root. Only problem with the repeated root is that you will get the same eigenvector, unique eigenvector. And once you have the unique eigenvector, you have to figure out that how to plot these solution trajectories, because the eigenvector is same. So that means ultimately the direction will be same. So the entering and exiting direction will always be same. So you have to understand that how to enter and how to exit. It's not a difficult thing. I think you can refer to any book and then you can do that, because I want to convey something which is there. So far what I have done is that I have discussed about a scalar equation. Then I went to the system of linear equation. And now I want to move what is called system of non-linear equation. So the system of non-linear equation are given in general by dx over dt is equals to fx. So these both are bold in terms. Therefore, these are system of non-linear equations. In order to know the behavior of the solution, that how to plot the solutions or how to figure out what will be the behavior in general, what will be the behavior of the solution, what we do is that we apply the process of linearization. In order to know the process of linearization, we want to figure out a very certain kind of solution. We call them critical point or the steady state solution. The critical points are defined as those points where dx over dt equals to zero. So we figure out the solutions for which dx over dt is equals to zero, or equivalently f of x is equals to zero. So on those points where f of x is zero, we call them as x star as the critical point. So we figure out those special solutions which are x stars, and we linearized our system f of f at those x stars. So what do we mean by linearization is that we shift the origin on that point. Okay, we shift the origin on that point. So if we shift the origin on that point, then that point behaves like a origin. Okay, so whatever discussion I was making here in this case of linear system, you can see in this in the case of this linear system, the origin is there, and the whole system behaves around the origin. If you look at it carefully, the whole system behaves around the origin. So the behavior around the origin can be easily figured and can be easily plotted, and that is the sole reason why we are doing that. So we first of all find the critical points, and then we shift our origin on that critical points. While shifting the origin on the critical point, we get the linear part, and we leave out the higher order term. The linear part is nothing but the Jacobian matrix of the function with respect to the variables. So let us take the example of a two-dimensional system where we have considered for a dx1 over dt is equals to f1 of x1 x2, and dx2 over dt is equals to f2 of x1 x2. For this, we replaced that our x old variable by x new plus x star. So this x still remains the x, but there is a difference. The old x is replaced by x new plus x star. This is how the shifting of the origin works. And once you do that and you use the Taylor series for two variables, you will figure out that you will get nothing but these derivatives. And this calculation leads to you to this system of equation, where this A is nothing but the Jacobian matrix. Notice that this linearized matrix, this is the linear system of matrix where A is the Jacobian matrix, which is evaluated at x1 star and x2 star. This is nothing but the linear system. And this linear system has 0, 0 as its critical point. And we have already discussed about how to find out the solution or how to figure out the solution of this linear system. So this is the whole idea of linearization. So that at that particular critical point, we can understand how the system will behave, or how the picture, this picture which we are trying to trace, that can be traced at that particular critical point. And this is what we will do for all the critical points. And then like a jigsaw puzzle, we will try to, we will try to club together all the pictures and make a bigger picture. Let us look at, let us not get into this particular aspect right now. Let us look at the qualitative solution of a nonlinear differential equation with the help of an example. And those who work in the biological system, they can easily understand this is a competitive model, two species competing for the same resource. So I'm not getting into, but those who don't want to care about that, these are just system of two nonlinear differential equations. So what are the critical points? As I told you, the critical point can be found by equating them to zero and solving these equations. So one can easily see that these are the four critical points. Okay, these are four critical points. One is origin, other is on the y-axis, this one is on the x-axis, and this one is on the interior of xy plane. So these are the critical points of this particular system. One important aspect is that when we say competition model, that means we are assuming that x1, x2 are population, and that means we usually deal with those critical points which are meaningful, for example, non-negative critical points only. So this is also one of the reasons we don't get out of, but in general, we can do for the whole R2 plane, but in this particular example, we will be only confining ourselves to the first quadrant of the R2 plane. So the idea will be like that. So let us start with the Jacobian matrix. This is my Jacobian matrix. And this Jacobian matrix, when evaluated at the first critical point 0, 0, it gives me 14, 16, 0, 0. One can easily see the eigenvalues are 14 and 16. And the corresponding eigenvectors are 1, 0. That means the x-axis and 0, 1. That means y-axis. So both the cases, you can see that lambdas are actually positive. And therefore, as t goes to infinity, you can easily see that the solution trajectories will move to the infinity. And as t goes to minus infinity, the solution trajectories will move to the 0, 0. Which one is the dominating eigenvector e raised to power 14t and e raised to power 16t? So 14 is smaller. And therefore, you can see that as t goes to infinity, then the eigenvector which is corresponding to 0, 1, which is y-axis. So it will be dominating direction. And when t is smaller, then 1, 0 will be the dominating direction. That means for beginning near the origin, x-axis will be the dominating direction. And ultimately, the solution will move parallel to the y-axis. And this is how we have plotted them. All right, this is how we have plotted them. During the question answer session, if you have a doubt, you can ask them. But right now I'm moving a little fast. So we start parallel to x-axis and we become little parallel to corresponding to y-axis. So this is how the solution trajectory is. As I told you, I am bothered about this computation model. Therefore, the similar plotting can be done on this side as well. But that plotting is not done here because, as I told you, this is considered as a computation model. So we are just plotting it in the first quadrant. So 0, 0, solution will start parallel to x-axis, but ultimately they will move parallel to y-axis. And similarly here, they will start parallel to x-axis and then they will move. So the solution, so this is a small picture at the 0, 0. Now what I will do is that I will similarly move my origin to 28, 0, 0, 32, and 12, 8 respectively. So let us move first to 0, 32. So once I move to 0, 32, this is my Jacobian matrix. And these are the corresponding eigenvalues. And these are the corresponding eigenvectors. And the corresponding eigenvalues can be easily seen that the dominating direction as t goes to infinity will be 0, 1. 0, 1 means y-axis. So as t goes to infinity, this will be the dominating direction. Lambdas are negative. That means you will approach to the origin. What is origin? The shifted origin. Okay. So that's why you can see as t goes to infinity, you become parallel to y-axis. Okay. As t goes to infinity, you become parallel to y-axis. And as t goes to minus infinity, you become parallel to 1, 16. This is the vector, eigenvector 1, 16. You're coming in parallel to 1, 16, do the movement in that direction, and then you enter this. Similar thing will happen from the other directions also, but this is how just one direction I have shown. There was a reason I will show you the complete picture, and then you can see that the other direction can also be shown. So this is basically parallel to the first example which I have shown, where both the eigenvalues were negative and both the eigenvectors were there. So you can actually plot other solution trajectories also. I have just plotted few of them here. All right. And then in the similar fashion, again, both the eigenvalues are negative and eigenvectors are there. The similar fashion we can plot here. Another solution trajectory will start parallel to this and then enter parallel to your x-axis, parallel to x-axis, okay? So this can be done. I think I can skip these details. There will be no problem if I skip these details. Let us move to the interior point. Let us shift our origin to 12, 8. So if I shift my origin to 12, 8, I can see the Jacobian matrix is this. This is the Jacobian matrix. And the corresponding eigenvalues are minus 5, minus root 97, which is negative, and plus 5, minus 5 plus root 97, which is positive. So one of the eigenvalues is positive and one of the eigenvalues is negative. This is interesting. Now I want to spend some time on this particular point. So one eigenvalue is negative, other eigenvalue is positive. Corresponding eigenvectors are given by this much. And this is almost 11 by 8, roughly you can say. This is almost 11 by 8, so larger than one number. And this is what you can call is that approximately this is also one, but with a negative size. So this basically number will be around 9 point something. This will be around 9 point something, which will make it minus of 8 point something and divided by 8. Therefore, this will be negative of minus 1. So larger the quantity which will be negative of minus 1. And this will be quantity which is larger than plus 1. So in other words, I can say that this is M1 and this is M2. Okay, M1 and M2. So M1 and minus M2, I'm sorry. This M1 and this is minus M2 because this quantity will be positive and this quantity will be negative. So when I plot these eigenvectors, I can easily see that one of them will be representing as y is equals to minus mx. For example, this one, this will be representing y is equals to, this will be representing y, sorry, y is equals to x. This will be representing y is equals to mx kind of line, and this will be representing y is equals to minus mx kind of line. So this y is equals to mx kind of line will be given by this this particular curve. And this particular curve will, as corresponding eigenvalue is negative, therefore you can easily see the direction will be inward, because as t goes to larger, then the direction goes inward. So as t goes to larger, the direction is inward. So y is equals to some m1x curve. These are the y is equal to m1x curve. They are parallel to this particular eigenvector, and they are inward. Now y is equals to minus m2x will be corresponding to these curve. Y is equal to minus m2x will be corresponding to these curve. And since eigenvalue is positive, so the direction will be outward. So here you can see that these directions are outward. So at 12, 8, two directions are inward and two directions are outward. What are the rest of the curves? So rest of the curve we have to see. So when I take the linear combination of the rest of the curve, I can easily tell you now, as t becomes larger, you can see that lambda being lambda one being negative, my this component will be smaller because minus infinity will become tending to zero. So then in that case, the lambda two eigenvector, which is this y is equal to minus x line, this is dominating. So as t is large, then the minus y is equal to minus x, some mx2 line, that will be the dominating direction. And as t is small, that means t tending to minus infinity, this will be the dominating direction. So it means that I will start with parallel to y is equals to mx line, and ultimately as t goes larger, I will become parallel to this lambda 2 direction, which is minus mx2 direction. So you can see that this is the curve, this is the solution curve which is making there. And similarly, I am starting parallel to this larger direction and then going to the smaller, and similar here, parallel to this, and then similarly here. So you can see that this we usually call as saddle, that solutions are initiating from some direction, and then after reaching near the origin, they will actually exit out. So they will enter and then they will exit. So it's like a flow coming from one side and then exiting from the other sides. So in one eigen direction, the flow is coming. So you can easily see the flow is coming from this direction, and the flow is exiting in this direction. Now we can actually complete the whole picture and join them together. So you can see that these are exiting directions. These are entering directions. The flow is entering and exiting from these directions. The flow is entering and exiting from these directions. This 28, 0, there the solution trajectory is becoming parallel to your x-axis. Similarly here, the solution trajectory exiting parallel to x-axis, moving parallel to y-axis, and then here they were again entering parallel to x-axis. So if this solution starts from here, this has to go somewhere, because the solution trajectory cannot, as I told you, the solution trajectory cannot cross these. This is one solution trajectory which is entering there. This is one solution trajectory which is exiting there. So if I start my solution trajectory from origin, I have to get back to 28, 0. Because otherwise, I have to cross this. Once I cross at any point, there will be two directions. And then that is not possible, because there is no point where there is two directions. This is because of the continuity. So my solution trajectory actually moved to 28, 0, which originate from the 0, 0. And similarly, this side, the solution trajectory which originate there, they move to 0, 32. And the other solution trajectory, they move to 0, 32. This solution trajectory, they move to 28, 0. So in whole, what we have done is that we have made small pictures by shifting our origin to these points, 12, 8, 28, 0, 0, 32, and all these points. And then we have actually clubbed them together and made the whole picture. What is important here is that there are certain curves, we call them as separatrix. So these curves basically separate the whole flow, in fact. So you can see that this particular curve and this particular curve, they are actually separating the flow. So the flow on one side. So this particular curve, you can easily see that if I take this particular curve, the flow, whole flow is moving towards the point 28, 0, and here the whole flow is moving to 0, 32. So if I am on, if I consider this is like a boundary. If I consider myself on one side of this curve, then I will move to 0, 32 ultimately. And if I am on this side of this particular curve, then I will ultimately move to 28, 0. So this is very important in case of biological models, that it tells that if your initial condition starts, let us say here, then you will reach to this particular point. And if your initial condition starts from here, then you will move to this particular point. And they have biological meaning, because then in one case, one particular variable is becoming zero. In other case, other particular variable is becoming zero. And therefore, they have certain meaning, certain biological meaning associated with them. So this gives us, biologically, this gives us a good insight of these models. So what I really wanted to convey from here is that if we have the linearization technique, then via linearization technique we can actually get the geometrical picture of the nonlinear system. There arises one question, that whether the linearization is valid or whether the linearization, whatever linearization we have done, whether that gives us the right picture or not. And for that, fortunately, we have a theorem which says that yes, it does, provided certain conditions hold. So before I get into, I will define something called hyperbolic critical point. So the critical point, we all know where this value vanishes, the point goes to zero. So hyperbolic critical point is a point where none of the eigenvalues of the linearized matrix have zero real part. That means either the eigenvalues have a positive real part or the negative real part. That is for sure. So we call it as hyperbolic critical point if all the eigenvalues are either with positive real part or with negative real part. There is a Hartmann-Grobman theorem. What does this theorem state? This theorem, roughly, this theorem tells that near a hyperbolic critical point, this is not exact statement of the theorem. Near the hyperbolic critical point, that means the critical point when there is no zero real part, the linearized system x dot is equals to ax has the same topological structure as the nonlinear system x prime is equals to fx. Well, this is very important result, because what we are doing, we are making pictures, or we are making the geometrical structures on the basis of linearized system. So the question arises whether your linearization is valid or not. So if my critical points are hyperbolic, then this theorem tells that clearly that yes, but however your linear system behaves, the behavior of the nonlinear system will be topologically equivalent. What do we mean by that is that you can actually define a homeomorphism from the linear solutions to the nonlinear solutions, and you can actually have a map. So essentially, it roughly tells that the solutions of the linear system will be little twisted and turned in case of nonlinear system, but the behavior will be more or less the same. Okay. Therefore, this particular theorem becomes an indispensable tool for analyzing nonlinear system, because this theorem gives you that if I know the structure of the linearized version corresponding to the hyperbolic critical point, if I know the structure of the linearized version corresponding to the hyperbolic critical point, I can actually tell how my non-linear system near that hyperbolic point I can tell how my non-linear system near that non-hyperbolic near that hyperbolic point will behave. So this gives me the equivalence of the linear system and the non-linear system. So if I'm able to tell the predict for the, I'm able to tell the, I'm able to show you the picture of the linear system, I can easily show you that how my nonlinear system will behave. So let us come back to this example again. This means the small pictures which we created corresponding to the origin, corresponding to 28, 0, corresponding to 12, 8, and corresponding to 0, 38, in a whole, when we join these pictures, then these pictures locally, these pictures are having the same meaning in the linearized version as in the non-linear version, and therefore the picture which I have drawn in front of you, that makes sense. Let me take another example without details here. This is just if you are interested, you can see. So here you can see that the critical point is 4, 6. The interior critical point is 4, 6. One can easily see that, and other critical point are 0, 8, 0, 0, and 7, 0. So in this case, in earlier case, it was a saddle. If you remember, I told you the saddle means one eigenvalue was negative, another eigenvalue was positive. But in this particular case, both the eigenvalues are negative. So you can see the whole picture changes. Though the idea does not change, you can draw the pictures in the similar fashion, but the whole picture changes, that everything moves towards this interior point 4, 6. All the solution trajectories, they move here towards this 4, 6. So just looking at this particular explanation and this particular picture, I can tell that how the system is behaving, what is happening. In fact, I want to correlate this with my example. So suppose like in earlier case, that was a competition model, as I told you. Competition means two species competing for the same resource. So if I consider X1 and X2 as two populations, so here it tells that whatever happens, only one of the species will survive. Because for the survivability of both the species, there is only one way through which you can reach to that 12, 8, when both of them will survive. And that is like out of almost impossible incidence. So if your initial condition change just a bit, either you fall on this side or on this side, you either make one variable to zero, or you make other variable to zero. That means if two species are competing for the same resource, then one of them will die out and only the other one will survive. Depending on that, which part of the initial condition or how the initial conditions are chosen, that means what are the environmental factors and all those things, you will be actually left with only one of the species. Whereas in this case, this shows the coexistence. This says that both the species will survive in this case. So here in this particular case, the way this system is taken, this says that both the species will survive. So if you look at the model system, you can see that this is also a competition, X1, X2. So these are the competitions which are there. So here also, but only thing is that this particular coefficient is having a different value, which is related to the intra-species competition. This particular term is related with the intra-species competition. So if this intra-species competition affects that the survivability of these populations, though those who are not from the population dynamics or those who are not from mathematical biology, they don't need to bother. They just need to bother about how we have actually found these solutions. So here are some references from where the most of contents are taken, apart from some other resources of books. If one is interested, one can go through these content of these books. And I acknowledge the resources of those books and notes and internet from where all these slides are prepared, and also the knowledge which I have acquired during all these years of my learning from my teachers. So I acknowledge all of them. Because of them, I could make this presentation. Thank you all for listening me patiently. I will be happy to answer any question or query if you have.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful and beautiful explanation, and you have presented every point in a nice way. You have taken a trajectory where it is negative, positive, showed all critical points, how they behave, the stability analysis of all the things. Thank you, sir, for your presentation. Now, any questions from the audience? Audience?
Yes, good afternoon, sir.
Ah.
Hello.
Please
tell.
Good afternoon, sir. Your presentation was very nice, sir.
Thank you.
Actually, I have one doubt, sir. So whatever linearization procedure you told,
yes,
whether that is valid for all type of nonlinear OD, sir?
Yes. So the procedure which I told, it is valid for all the case of nonlinear equations. So this is what in general what you do is that this is basically shifting of origin. So this is my x old, I replace it by x new plus x star, and this is what I do in my system. So my system was dx1 over dt is equals to f1 of x1 x2. So in that I have just replaced it. So it is a simple procedure of your, this is nothing but Taylor series essentially. This is nothing but Taylor series in a higher dimension. Okay. And this is why you are getting the Jacobian. If you remember your Taylor series in a higher dimension, that is nothing but your Jacobian and Hessian and so on and so forth. So this is what you get. So what you do is that from that right hand side is a function. Right hand side is a function in Rn, and you use the Taylor series in Rn. So you will get Jacobian, and then you will get Hessian and so on and so forth. You just ignore Hessian, and then you will be getting Jacobian only. So this is simply thing in that words, it is just a Taylor series expansion for the right hand side function.
Suppose, sir, I am having a system of OD, nonlinear OD, dx by dt plus x into dy by dt equal to f1, and dy by dt plus x dx by dt equal to f2. So how can I find the Jacobian, sir?
Can you repeat the equation again? Dx over dt equals to?
Dx by dt plus y into dy, x into dy by dt is equal to f1. And dy
all
by
right,
dt.
Okay. So now what is happening here, this is not in the form which I have told you.
Yeah, that's only I am asking, sir.
Yes. So in order to, first of all, I have to convert that equation in my framework, okay?
Uh-huh.
Okay. So you have to simplify, you have to solve the equation. Dx over dt plus something of dy over dt is equals to f1. And then again, dx over dt plus something of dy over dt is equals to, let us say, f2. So we have to use some algebraic method to solve them. And we have to write the equation so that I can write dx over dt equals to some function, dy over dt equals to some function. In fact, any general nth order differential equation can always be represented in this form.
No. Can you give me some idea how to solve that nonlinear part? That's my question, sir. F1, F2 is okay, but how can we bring that one to the present form, whatever form you told? Any technique can you suggest me?
This is the same way, as I told you, this is the same way. You don't need to, you just need to simplify the equation, convert the equation in this form. If you write down and send the equation to me, maybe within 15 minutes, I will reply it back on my email. So this is my email, you just send it to me, because at this moment, I think if everybody...
I will contact you, sir, by mail, sir.
Yes, you can send me email. I think I will be able to let you know that how. The only point is that you have to convert the equation in that specific form. Say, for example, I need my equation to be written x1 prime is equals to some function, x2 prime equals to some function.
Yeah,
so similarly, your dx over dt, dy over dt, you have to solve them. Whatever you do, you have to solve them, and you have to write them in this particular form only. Once you are able to do that, then only my further analysis works. So
okay, but then in case of eigenvalue, I can get the variable also, sir.
Pardon?
In case of eigenvalue, here you are getting constant eigenvalues. In that case, I may get the variable as the eigenvalues.
So this whole analysis is about what I am calling is autonomous system. Autonomous system means the system which are free from the variable x directly. So I mean the independent variable directly.
Yes.
In case of non-autonomous system, the whole theory changes. Okay.
Whatever I have discussed,
that will not work for non-autonomous system.
That is my query, sir. That is my query.
No. That will not work. Whatever I have discussed only for autonomous system only. I mentioned that we will be discussing here in this talk. We shall consider only autonomous equations. So we have discussed only for the autonomous. Non-autonomous theory is different and it is far more tedious than this one. So this is, I mean, that is like something which is very different.
Simple doubt, sir.
Yes, please.
What is the geometrical meaning of eigenvalue and eigenvector?
So I think in most of the books you must have studied the geometrical meaning of eigenvalue and eigenvector. It is like a quantity which, if you see in the two-dimensional space, it helps. You take any book of linear algebra, there you will find that they take the example of two-dimensional space. So say, for example, Ax is equals to lambda x. So what the operator A does, what the operator A does is actually when it is operated on a x vector, it actually either elongates it or shrinks it to lambda units of time. So this means that that along the eigenvector and along the eigendirections, rather I should say, you either move, you can say you expand yourself or you shrink yourself depending on how the eigenvalues are. So that is how it can be very easily seen when you consider it in two-dimensional space. You consider a matrix, and then with the help of that, you can consider that what is the meaning, like Ax is equals to lambda x. So if you choose the eigenvector, you will see that if it is 2x, then if you operate the matrix on that vector A, it will elongate it 2 unit time. So if you are starting from the point x comma y, you will reach to the point 2x comma 2y. That is what essentially your eigenvalues and eigenvector geometrically does. And there is a nice geometrical application also conic sections. I think you can figure it out somewhere.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
So I think the conditions for the critical point to be stable, stable, unstable, and the cusp, I think the conditions can also be given for certain cases.
So, my purpose in this talk was only to explain the geometrical meaning, and therefore I have not touched anything like stability or anything.
Okay.
So I did not even define the idea of stability. If you see.
Mm.
Obviously, the stability is an inherent part, but I have not defined the idea of stability or cusp or any kind of bifurcation or any kind of folding, nothing. I just tried to convey that from a very simple idea, how you can see the geometrical, geometrically, how you can see the differential equation in one dimension and in a higher dimension. So my whole idea of talk was on based on that.
Okay.
It was not essentially based for the stability theory. Of course,
okay.
Once you go to the higher dimension, then the geometrical interpretation becomes difficult. And in that case, as you rightly pointed out, the eigenvalue, because whole idea of eigenvalue starts coming in, and then via eigenvalue, we can talk about the stability and the other properties. And then we can talk about how the system is behaving. Yes. So we can get the information. That is, again, falls in that qualitative analysis. Rightly pointed out, yes.
Okay. Any other question from the audience?
Professor Srivastava, this is Ganapati Subramanian.
Yes.
In example one, you have chosen Picard's method. Any reason behind that?
Yes. So the reason was that we can, first let me be clear with your question. You are asking me to choose this particular example, or you are asking me to choose the Picard's iterative scheme?
No. Why you are using Picard's scheme in example one?
Right. So I wanted to show you that. See, this is about the continuity of the talk. I had this in my mind. Maybe you might find it out of the place, but I thought that those who are probably not aware about the solutions of the differential equation, they can probably correlate, because here what I did not find the solution. Normally what we do is that whenever such kind of equations are given, we usually tell that okay, you find the integrating factor, multiply both sides by the integrating factor, which is e raised to power minus t here, and then you integrate, and then you can figure out the solutions will be. But normally we are not told that we can actually construct the solution via Picard iterates. So my idea or my thought when I was preparing the slide was that okay, instead of going for the solution or instead of describing the solution directly, can I give that the feel that okay, the existence and uniqueness theorem equally helps, not only telling that there will be solution, but it can also help in certain cases that how that solution can be found out. And this is how I have done that, this solution I tried to find using this Picard. So that was the basic idea. So this point here, which I have mentioned in my slide, they also sort of follow what I wanted to say, is that this construction of the solution can be done via Picard iterates. That is what my intention was.
Thank you, sir.
Any other clarification needed? Any other participants would like to ask question? Umamaheshwari, any questions from your side?
No, sir.
Any other participants would you like to ask question? See, whatever professor presented is only. You can say a little bit, and we organized the program for 10 days. It was very difficult for us to organize even for 2 days or 3 days in person. Usually we do the we organize the national conference or international conference or any other short-term training program for 2 days or 3 days. It's very difficult to arrange for more than 5 days, but in online it was made possible. Whatever the class, whatever courses, whatever talks, whatever process they have delivered the lectures, it's only a bucket of water from a very big ocean. Still, we can take more such buckets of water. Okay. Still, we have got a lot of scope for improvement. Still, we would like to organize more such programs in future. Any questions from the audience? Any questions from the participants? Anything would you like to say?
So, Professor Anurachalam, I think some of the participants are asking for slides.
Yeah. They informed me that they want PowerPoint. Can you share the PowerPoint?
Yes. I will be sharing it. If you can provide me, I think I can share it with Bala, Dr. Bala.
Yes, sir. Bala Muladharan, in turn, you will share to me, we can pass on to the participants, sir.
Yes, so please, you do it at your end. Yes. I will share these slides.
Okay.
Yes.
So, very good presentation from your side. Thank you for sparing your valuable time with us. It was a very nice presentation overall.
Thank you so much. I think now can we disconnect?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you everyone for listening to me. And I will definitely share these slides with Dr. Balaji or Professor Anurachalam, and then hopefully they will be shared with you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for giving a session.
Thank you, Akitan. It was nice seeing you during this time.
Yes, sir. You can also share to me also, sir.
In this junction, I request one. Can you share the recorded video to our faculty members?
Yes, sir. Actually, we are going to upload all the recorded videos in our website. Within 1 or 2 weeks, you can easily.
Yes, sir. At the time, you can understand if the video will be very useful for recollecting our knowledge and the concepts, everything.
Yes, you are right. As you suggested, definitely we'll share to you, and also it will be shared on the website so that any faculty member who is interested, definitely they can go through the video again.
Sure. Okay, sir. So, very nice program, sir. Very long, more than 10 days, nearly. Thank you so much.
Because of online only, it was possible. Otherwise, it's very difficult to conduct such programs in person. Anyhow, we have to thank COVID for making such
another kind of the benefit. Yeah, maybe some we facing some difficulty, but this type of the benefit we are facing.
yes, definitely, definitely.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Because in person, if you organize, you have to pay flight ticket, organizing food.
Food, everything is very.
Everything is there. Now we are able to do it in online.
Yes, sir.
You can say not even cost. Not cost.
Yes.
So somewhere other COVID is doing something wonderful things.
Yes, sir.
Anyhow.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for your view and comments.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. So any other point of view? Any other thing? So if there are no other thing, we'll close. We'll say goodbye to all. And we'll meet again for more such programs in future. Tomorrow we are going to organize a research development program for all the research scholars. Here we are not forcing all the staff members to attend, but interested staff members can always attend. It is their choice, but the research scholars of mathematics department may be allowed, may be permitted to allow, may be attended on a daily basis, and we want them to attend compulsorily. Research scholars from other department, it is their choice only. We want all the scholars of maths department to attend without fail. This is our request we would like to make now.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So if there are no other thing, I think we can close the meeting and we can say goodbye to all.
Thank you, sir.
Excuse me, sir. Uma Maheshwari.
Please.
Sir, is it online book punting, sir?
Balamudran is going to book now. He said he has committed, and definitely it is booked from 2:30 to 4, I think. We'll prepone it by half an hour. Definitely it'll be there, don't worry.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So any other thing? So shall we close the meeting?
Yeah.
If it is in person, we can take photograph, but now online, I don't know.
Yeah, I'll share in group, sir.
Okay, then.
Oh, took photo, sir.
Coordinator, sir.
Special thanks to
you.
Saturated,
All the co-hosts, not only you. The teamwork, actually. Teamwork always works.
Even HOD also not sleeping up to 2 o'clock night, actually.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much for your efforts.
Not only myself. He is also not sleeping up to 2 p.m. night, 2 a.m.
Yes, sir. From the mail, you know, sir.
My daughter, same. Say thank you, man. Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your call.